together. And by the way, this is the safest possible place that you could be with the virus, because we all have been here long enough that we have durable, permanent. What am I going to say? Immunity to the virus. But that's another story. The Word of God says, "The Lord, the God of my salvation, let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry. To the new Jerusalem." That takes us to verse 14. And we go from what he was wearing to his own person. His head and his hair were white like white wool. Voice. His hand, his mouth, his face. We're getting a picture of the exalted Christ. His head and his hair are like white wool, like snow. Daniel 7:9, that messianic passage where we find the term Son of Man, describes God the Almighty in the same way. So Christ bears the same characteristics as God the Almighty. The white here is lukon. Not a flat white, but a blazing white, a shining white, like light white. What does this mean? Well, it means he's uncorrupted by evil. Pure light, blazing glory, the white light of his eternal, glorious, pure holiness. And out of that blazing, pure holiness, the Shekinah that appeared even in the garden, came two penetrating streams like a laser. John sees this, and the face of Christ is a blazing light, and coming out of it are two laser flames. Nothing will cause him to stop loving his church. Nothing will cause him to take back forgiveness for the sins of his church. But that does not mean he is indifferent to their sin. Jonah tried to hide, didn't he? To run from God. Then to go down deep in the ship to hide. He can't hide from God. The Lord is present in his church. He's interceding for his church. And he's also looking with laser holiness at the behavior of his church. According to 2 Corinthians 11:3, he wants the bride to be a chaste virgin. He wants to present a chaste virgin to Christ. That's Paul's desire. The Lord Jesus Christ gave his life to sanctify and cleanse the church. He wants Ephesians 5, a pure bride, as in 2 Corinthians 11. He wants the church holy, so that the first instruction that comes to the church is Matthew 18. And if somebody sins, you go to them, you confront the sin. If they don't repent, you take two or three witnesses. If they don't repent, you tell the church. If they still don't repent, you throw them out. Virgin. For love of Christ, for joy, for usefulness, for witness, he confronts the sin of his church. And he acts. His feet, verse 15, are like burnished bronze when it has been made to glow in a furnace. Red hot, gleaming brass. Judgment in the church. He will judge. How does he judge? Could be by death, could be by illness, could be by exposure, just exposure. But his judgment is severe, blazing, molten, pure, fine, gleaming feet of judgment. He wants his church so pure that he will. Christ moving in his church? He is. He's alive in his church, he's interceding for his church, and he is with pure, holy omniscience, fully aware of the sins of his people, and will bring judgment on them. Doesn't mean the loss of salvation. Does mean the loss of joy, and could mean the loss of life. John is being encouraged. The Lord wants the purity of the church more than he does. And his word speaks with authority. That's why Titus says, speak with all authority. So the good news is, the Lord is speaking to his church, his true church, with authority. We know where that comes from. It comes from his word. There's a fifth aspect of this vision that encourages John and us. In his right hand, he held seven stars. Let's just say he controls his church. He controls his church. What are these seven stars? Down in verse 20, it says, they are the angels, better the messengers. They are the leaders, the shepherds. It's the word angelos, and it is often translated angels, of course, but it's the same word for messengers. This is good news. He controls the leaders in his church. He will never be without faithful leaders. He will always have faithful leaders. He will always have godly leaders. You may have to sort through the pile to get to them. But he gave Ephesians 4 to his church, evangelists, pastors, evangelists, teaching pastors, as he gave apostles and prophets in the past. He always has faith in him. So what is he doing in his church? He's alive in his church, purifying his church, interceding for his church, proclaiming truth to his church, disciplining his church when necessary. And then I love this, back to verse 16, protecting his church. Out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword. What's that for? The feet were the instruments of judgment in the image. What is the sword for? Turn over to chapter 2, verse 16. Hurry through this. Given up on his church. I hate when I hear these people say that. Come join our little cult. This church is no good to me. Basta. Come to work. So many people picking at the church. The Lord is still shining the light of his glory through his church. Which is to say that at the end of everything, evangelism is the purpose. That people might see the church and see through the church the glory of the Lord. So we who are part of the church don't need to be discouraged. Through this last period of time, we might have had a lot of reason to be discouraged. But just the opposite has turned out, hasn't it? We've seen the Lord do all these things. It's been an incredible journey. And he's been alive in our midst. Many have come to faith in Christ. He has enriched our fellowship beyond what we could ever imagine. He has disciplined us. He has purified us. He continues to speak to us with authority through his word. Commanding, controlling, sovereignly. And he has allowed his face, the face of his glory, to shine through his church. And we give him all praise and all. ministry that I've led here. Any greater display of the Lord's work in his church than I've seen in the last 18 months.